Mr. Mahapatra, could you please recall the first poem you wrote, the one you consider significant? How did that come about?
It was ages ago, and I really don't remember. The first poem, I suppose I wrote a number of poems at that time, but I wouldn't be able to say or give the label significant to one of those poems. Maybe all of those poems came together at the same time. And that was a long time back. I never knew I would write, but I suppose circumstances made me take up a pen and try this new medium of poetry. It was also incidental, I would say.
It was the year 1971, maybe?
No. I think it was much earlier. 68? No, probably 68. Or maybe 67 or 66. Could be around that time. Because I remember I published my... Yeah, now I remember. I published my first significant poem. What you would call significant, a critic would call significant, in a journal called South and West. In the United States of America in 1967 I would say.
What about that poem, the report card, that...
The report card. The report card was written in 1969. And... I submitted it to a poetry contest in London, and somehow it got through.
You often written in your prose pieces that you started writing short fiction, but then you shifted later to poetry. In what circumstances did that shift occur?
Well, the answer is very simple. I wanted to write fiction at the beginning, and I wrote a number of short stories, sent them out to the Illustrated Weekly of India, which was then being edited by a Britisher called Mr. Mandy, Mr. C.R. Mandy. But then Mr. Mandy thought my stories were all rubbish, so he sent them back as injection slips. And I thought that my career as a writer would never happen. So it never happened, I gave it up. I gave up writing for a long, long time. And then, as I said, this was early when I was about almost 20, 21, 22. And I thought I would never be able to write, so I never wrote. I tried my hand at many other things, and then went over to research in physics, went over to photography, went over to other things. And then poetry came much later, as I said.
When you started writing poems, did you come across the journals in which you published letters, like the Shivani Review? Did you read that journal before you started writing poems?
No. No. It was, I was teaching in the Ravenshaw College. And the Ravenshaw College had a really superb library where they used to get critical and creative journals and magazines from the UK and the USA. And so my forays into the library helped me to pick up the journals that I later submitted my poetry to. But I had never seen those journals prior to my writing poetry. It was later on that I began to read poetry that appeared in these prestigious journals.
Your submission to journals in the US, especially in the US, you have published heavily, more than in England.
Oh yes.
So, what was the year in which you published in poetry? the first publication in Poetry Chicago.
I think it was the year 1974. I sent a number of poems, a group of poems, to the editor, and the editor accepted the poems, and I thought he liked my poems very much, because a beginner like me would not have been able to publish a group of four poems in the significant journal Poetry, and later on a group of seven poems, again in another issue. And so these 11 poems appeared in one particular year, in the year 1975. Yes, that's right. That gave me a indeed a good boost to write poetry. I knew I could write.
I think you are the only poet from India writing in English who believes that writing poems in English and getting them published or trying them with the foreign journals should go together. Why is it so? Is it to vindicate?
No, it's because otherwise, here, because our criticism, I don't think, is of that that quality that I seek, that I want. So when I sent a poem or a group of poems to foreign journals, and when an editor publishes those poems, accepts those poems, I feel that my poems are of that standard, that equates to international standards, to other poems, to other poets. And so I know that I was writing well, otherwise a poet, an editor wouldn't take my poems and pay for the poems as well. That's important for me.
That was a time when your poems were, in a way, addressed to the foreign readership, which is not the case anymore with your recent poems.
No. Yeah, you couldn't just make such an absolute statement. I wrote, that was all. And I sent the poetry out, I sent the poems out. But why do you say that I was writing for a poem? That's because I published heavily. That does not give you that concluding remark to make. Doesn't give you to make that concluding remark. I just wrote. I was writing conscientiously. I was writing severely, seriously. And then, because I was writing so many poems at that time, because I was in that mood of creative surge, I suppose I could publish them. And it wasn't meant for foreign audiences, not like that. It could have been published also here in India, but then we didn't have enough magazines here for them to get published in.
What made me to think like that is that there are so many Indian elements in those poems. Maybe those images or the thing you are talking about were self-explanatory in the poem, so that it didn't need any footnotes. Without footnotes, those poems were appreciated beyond the sea. That speaks that those poems were universal in quality, even though they dealt with themes specific to the locale.
Well, I was born in Orissa, I have lived in Orissa. It was very, very natural that I wrote about the place I lived in. And so I wrote about my place, my people, my earth, my air, my water. My poetry was therefore very localized, but then when you go on to talk about the beyond or the universal after the locale quality in the poems, I wouldn't be able to tell you anything about that. It's just that I wrote and then I wanted to publish, so I sent them out. And was happy when the editors didn't question me about the varying customs and the culture pertaining to Orissa or India.
There are many poems like The Myth, The Indian Way, Temple Street, Puri. So those are the poems which dealt with our locale, yet they spoke to the foreign audience. It could be like that, it had an element of mystery in your language which appealed to them, that made them overlook the peripheral things that surrounded the poems.
Mm. Could be, I couldn't say, but then Professor Cox, C.B. Cox, he said that it was the first time in the 14 years of the journal's existence that he had ever published any poetry from India. And that was very important for me, because if a foreign editor could understand our customs, our culture, our way of living, and then accept the poems and publish the poems in a big group, in a large group in his journal, that said much for his generosity, and also it gave me that confidence which I needed to proceed with my poetry.
Right. Again, many of your books are published from US and again from Australia, maybe the temple. Mm-hmm. So those publishers never asked for any glossary for the work. That is very important. That means it seemed that they used to understand what you are trying to say.
I can't answer your question. Maybe not. Maybe they were indifferent. Maybe they wanted to publish. I wouldn't be able to explain.
But Tempur, the other long poem besides Relationship, is such a complex work, in such complex structure. It is very significant. It's a very significant work in the sense that you are dealing with that principle, feminine principle,
yes,
the cult of Shakti.
Yes.
But
yes,
the exploration was to such a level that it is very difficult to fathom that level. Mm-hmm. How did it come about, that long poem?
I don't know. It was Anna Rutherford, editor of Kunapiti, and who was running the Dangaroo Press in Australia. She said, when I submitted the manuscript to her, she said that she would publish it. And I felt happy that at least here was a totally, totally Indian poem, set in a totally, completely Indian milieu, which had a lot of myth in it, which had a lot of mysticism too. If that could be accepted, that was something that I could say was graciousness in the part of foreign editors to my poetry. Maybe I was lucky, let's put it that way. I was fortunate to have my poetry published.
It's cutting across the cultural barrier. Again, that temple poem, or the other poem, Relationship, which was again published from New York.
Yes.
It dealt with your locale, with yourself, your intimate relationship with the people surrounding you. I am curious to know if the beginning of that long poem which won you Sahitya Academy Award, its beginning is like that, like this: once again one must sit back. I am curious to know if these were the words that first occurred to you, or you worked upon it and read these words later on, if you don't mind to reveal the...
No, I don't remember. Because the original manuscript now is with the people at Bharat Bhavan, Bhopal. But I think I didn't change the words of the of the poem. The first lines are just...
They're absolutely lyrical.
Yes, they are. I don't think I've changed that. Maybe I've changed later portions of the poem.
But not the beginning
ones. Not the beginning.
That's a wonderful beginning.
Yeah, I think, I don't know how I wrote it. Because now if you ask me to write that poem, I'll never be able to write two stanzas of the poem.
Beautiful.
That's over, it's over. And it's over with a part of my life as well.
Mr. Mahapatra, your new poems, as one reads them in your latest work, Random Descent, or in journals, are about abject social reality, about your painful process of aging. Now that you have reached the age of 80, how do you feel about your act of writing, about life, your life and life as such around you?
Well, I suppose age comes to everyone else, so I'm not particularly worried about aging right now. The point is, things have changed drastically in the last 5 to 10 years in India. And our conditions of living seem to be managed by hate and greed. The specter of violence that's always there at the back of your mind. You feel you are not safe anymore. You feel there are a lot of things going on around you that you cannot help. But then you have to live through all of these. And poetry, because you know that when you write a poem, it takes your mind away from all these things. Maybe it helps to live your life a little better, or it helps to live, you to live in the way you would want life to be. And this despair that is there comes through in your poetry. So my latter poems do talk about these things, do talk about the despair about which one cannot do anything. But then you have only to sit down and write your sorry or your sad poem at midnight or early mornings. That's all that is there.
Last year, at the very personal level, Mrs. Mahapatra passed away. It must have made a lot of difference to you.
Yes, you are right. There was a setback. It was so sudden, it was so unexpected, that for the first few days or the first few weeks, it was difficult to reconcile oneself to the thought that she wasn't there. But today, when I walk around the house, I feel that she's there. Her presence is there. I don't feel that loneliness much. And when people ask me, are you feeling lonely? I said, no, not that way. I'm lonely, yes. But that loneliness makes me a different person. I suppose it makes me a better person. And I can cope with this loneliness in a positive way. I can use that loneliness to build my line in the poem I'm going to write, and that is important for me.
Thank you for your such words of wisdom, and which gives us a lot of strength also. It's enlightening for us, though at the same time it is so sad. But then, I can't recall.
Welcome. Everything will go on as usual, you know. So many great people have died, and we live on their words, so we will go on as usual.
Thank you. But then before leaving, just one question which will make us rather light. Could you please tell something about your very satisfying moments in your writing life? Just one.
Yes, as I said, I could cite not only one, but four such moments in my writing career that have left an indelible impression on me. Moments of joy, I could say, moments of joy which are intermixed with moments of sadness too. I remember once when I was reading my poetry in Atlanta, there was a Brazilian student who was there, a Brazilian woman, young woman, who simply walked out of the room when I was reading my poem with tears in her eyes. And then later on, when the reading was over and I went over and talked to her, and we talked about so many things, and she said how much my poetry moved her. And that is something that a poet cannot forget. That is what gives a poet the greatest satisfaction in his life. I suppose this is more than what an award can give. This is more than what a recognition can give. It's the point of touch which from the poet to the reader or the poet to the listener, that's very important for a poet. And if that's happened to you, well, poetry has done its work.
So, poetry makes things happen.
Sure, certainly, I do believe. Even if it is 0.001% of our people who read poetry and are moved by poetry, poetry does make things happen.
Thank you for your wonderful. Thank you.
You're welcome.